Okay, welcome to the next part on our series on differentials. And we're going to just take a constructive approach to the question of really what are differentials? And specifically, we're going to ask the question, can we construct an algebra of differentials on the real numbers? When I was a kid riding my tricycle to calculus class, differentials were a politically incorrect concept in math class. The mathematics texts of the time did not mention differentials or define them. Calculus was developed without them. On the other hand, after having my math class, I would go over to my physics class and we would have Newtonian mechanics and electrodynamics packed full of differentials and differential calculus. So were physicists just too dumb to know that differentials were bad, or are differentials really a mathematically rigorous construction? In later years, in later decades, differentials came back in a big way, and they're natural in the construction of calculus on manifold. So somehow or another, differentials got rehabilitated. But we're going to ask this simple question, can we construct an algebra of differentials on the real numbers such that a number like this, dx, is an element of the real numbers? Well, differentials are small, kind of arbitrarily small real numbers. So let's take a look at a set of small numbers. Let's look at the closed interval minus 1 to 1. Look at its algebraic properties. First of all, if you multiply, let's call this set in 1 of 0. So it's a neighborhood of 0 of size 1. Well, if you multiply any two numbers in this interval, you get another number in the neighborhood in 1. So multiplication is closed on the set in 1. So that's kind of interesting. What about an epsilon neighborhood? So now we're going to define an epsilon neighborhood of the number 0, and that's going to be the set of all dx. So this will be an open neighborhood of 0. That epsilon is greater than 0, but arbitrarily less than. Well, notice that if you take any two small numbers and multiply them together, you get an even smaller number. So if you have A and B elements of the neighborhood n epsilon of 0, then A times B is equal to C, which is also much less than 1, and it's also C is an element of the neighborhood n epsilon of 0. So that's sort of interesting. So multiplication of these two numbers in an epsilon neighborhood gives you another number. Notice also that the cardinality of the set of numbers in epsilon of 0 is equal to the transfinite number aleph 1. I'm not going to use the Hebrew alphabet, just we'll call this aleph 1 as the cardinality of this set, and this is equal to the cardinality of the real numbers. Okay, so they're both uncountable infinities of elements in both sets, real numbers and an epsilon neighborhood of 0. And that's interesting because it means that there's a one-to-one mapping, a bijection between the real numbers and any epsilon neighborhood. So that's a powerful property of epsilon neighborhoods in the real numbers. So in a sense, anything we do in an epsilon neighborhood can be converted into algebraic operations on the real numbers as a whole using this bijection f. And, you know, we'll want f to be continuous and so on, all the needed properties. Okay, so let's take a look at this a little bit more. So what sort of algebra do we have here on N1? What official name algebra on the epsilon neighborhood? Well, we're going to show that that multiplication of elements of the epsilon neighborhood is a semigroup operation, but it is not a group operation. The element 0 has no inverse in epsilon. So 0 causes this n epsilon to fail to be a group. Furthermore, the inverse of a differential is not an element of n epsilon 1. So 1 over dx is very much larger than 1 if dx is an element of an epsilon neighborhood of 0. Notice that the element sign here, don't confuse it with this epsilon. It's an unfortunate notation, but it's standard. Element of relation is sort of like a stretched out epsilon like this. If I write it as, and it looks like epsilon, just from the context, it should be obvious. Okay, so no inverse. Well, let's recall what a group is. The real numbers do not constitute a group under multiplication because the inverse of 0 doesn't exist as a real number. So if 0 does not have an inverse, so any subset of the real numbers that has a 0 in it cannot be a group. There's a set of elements, and there is a multiplication defined. So if A and B are elements of G, then A times B equals C must also be an element of G. There is an inverse, so we were talking about inverses. A inverse exists such that A times A inverse equals 1, the identity element. So groups need to have an identity. So call it the identity, call it 1 exists. 1 times any A is equal to A. Group algebra is an associative algebra, is the same as A B times C. Okay, is there anything more we need to define a group? Well, certainly in the real numbers you have a extra property here, which is commutivity. Put a star by that because you don't have to have commutivity to be a group. So it has a significant algebraic structure. Here's another property, ordering. The real numbers are a totally ordered set. That means that if you have any two distinct elements, A, B, any two distinct elements of the real numbers, then there is a relationship that either A must be less than B or the other way around. That means that you can place every element in the real numbers in an ordered sequence, and that allows you to draw and represent the real numbers in a, you know, in a graphic form where you have some kind of continuous curve like this, and so you can choose a zero on here and then label every point along this curve with a real number in order of, say, increasing values of the real numbers. Another property of the real numbers is that they have a magnitude, and that's denoted by the absolute value sign. Minus 3 is equal to 3. The magnitude of 0 is equal to 0. So the magnitude operation is mapping the real numbers onto the set of non-negative real numbers. So there are a bunch of sort of powerful properties, and we were looking at the idea that we'd like to consider differentials as actual elements, actual real numbers. So if that's the case, then you'll have kind of a host of extra properties you can invoke from time to time. for a set of elements to be a group is 1 through 4. So this is a group, an algebraic group. Now, what about our epsilon neighborhood? We noted that elements of the epsilon neighborhood do not have a multiplicative inverse in the neighborhood. So that means we do not have the inverse element. So this one, property 2, is not obeyed. Furthermore, if we require that all the elements in our algebra are going to be in an epsilon neighborhood, one is going to be excluded, one isn't going to be in our neighborhood. So we do not have an identity. And what's left? Well, we have 4, and we actually get to have 5 too. So our algebra of differentials is closed under multiplication. So number 1 is obeyed, and it is associative. 2 is obeyed. This type of algebra is called a semigroup. And it's closed and associative. We get an extra property. It is commutative. You might call this a commutative semigroup, or maybe even an abelian. Going through this little detour into group theory is that we'd like to construct an algebra on the differentials, and this allows us to classify that algebra, the multiplicative algebra of differentials, as a commutative semigroup. In the context of the real numbers, we need to know this algebraic properties of the elements of the neighborhood. So the dx's elements of n epsilon 0 are a semigroup. Now the 0 poses a problem because we would like to be able to look at the set of the multiplicative inverses of the dx's, the set of these things. We'd like the multiplicative inverse of dx to be an element of R. And so this is going to give us an additional algebraic structure on differentials if we can define an algebra of inverse differentials. So let's take a look at this, and we're going to exclude the point. So this is a set, but we're going to exclude the element 0. So I'm going to just call this n epsilon. We're going to exclude the element 0. So it's sometimes called a punctured neighborhood. Because all these dx's are real numbers, we can certainly construct 1 over dx, and we've chosen that so that for every differential in the set n epsilon bar excluding 0, 1 over dx is a real number. This is a set of arbitrarily large real numbers. We're going to name this set 1 over dx is an element of n epsilon star that consists of numbers of the form 1 over dx. So these are going to, since the dx's are really small, 1 over dx is going to be really large. In fact, since dx is arbitrarily small, it means that 1 over dx can be arbitrarily large. So let's take a look. Let's draw a picture of this. This set here is also called the dual of n epsilon of 0. And I'm not going to put the bars on all of these things, so we're going to take it that we will exclude the point 0, so that this n epsilon that we're dealing with is a disjoint set, consists of positive and negative numbers in between plus and minus epsilon, and excluding the number 0, so on both sides of 0. So let's just see how this looks pictorially here.